entendemos.
See,
It's all who you complain to. There's no sense in me complaining to my wife or my children. They can't help me. Not with this problem I have. But the Lord told me to cast all my cares. See, I can complain to Jesus all day long. He the one that can handle it. Amen. He can change things. Hallelujah. But thank God for my good days outweighing my bad days. Amen. Heard a lot of people say, well, it's not going to do you any good to complaining. I beg to differ, because if I go to the Lord in prayer, hey, he's going to hear my every care. Hallelujah. Amen. Yes, sir. He might not be there when I want him, but he'll answer them by and by. I just have to keep casting all my cares upon the Lord. Amen. Cry out to the Lord. Let us pray. Lord God, I thank you right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, on how you started me on my way. Lord, you was the one that kept me in my right mind. You were the one, Lord, that took me here, took me from there, and brought me here. Now I ask, oh God, that you word my mouth. Lord, help me to live this word. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I know that this is not just only for me, that your word is for all of us. But Lord, it came to me that I might make a change in my life. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you for what you've done for me and what you're going to continue to do. So God, that you continue to strengthen me in this old body. In Jesus' name, amen. This is not old body. I'm a young man, but amen. It's amen. Every now and then. Every now and then. I thank God for Bishop Dessel Benjamin, Mother Mildred Benjamin, amen. We thank God for how you continue to be strong, stay strong, even though we might not see when you break down. Amen. You still continue to look strengthened, and amen, and still walking with the Lord. Thank God for our pastor, Elder Sanchez Hogg. The Lord is continuing to use you in a mighty way. Thank God for the word that he's put in you, amen, to bring forth to this congregation, that we may, amen, continue in the walk in the way of the Lord. Amen. I thank God for my wife, amen, for, amen, putting her into my life. Amen. We've been together now, married legally for 32 years, come November the 17th. Amen. Amen. She's my first and last. I always say that. Amen. Because, amen, to death do us part. Amen. The good times, the bad times, for the richer or the poor. Amen. She's going to be my wife to the end. Amen. If I go first, so be it. If she go first, so be it. But I know that'll be the end of that. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, hallelujah. I don't know if I could start over again. Amen. But I thank God for what he's doing right now. Amen. Because God has been so good to us. I don't know. He's been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Amen. He's treat each and every one of us, amen, the same no matter how we fall short. But God has been good to us. Amen. I thank God for, amen, what he's doing for us in our life. Amen. We're going to go to the scriptures. Amen. I thank God for each and every one of you. You know what? We don't know each other better. Amen. But, you know, by and by, the Lord will have us continue to grow and know one another. Amen. So we in the book of Acts, the 27th chapter. This one is this has been hard for me. This right here. This word. But I thank God for it because it's going to do what it's going to do. Amen. I'm going to read a little bit out of the New Living Translation. Acts 27 chapter. I'm going to start at that 10th verse. It's a lot in this chapter, but amen, we're only going to get one thing out of it tonight. We'll probably get much more than one thing. Amen. This is Paul talking. He said, "Sirs, I believe there is trouble ahead if we go ahead. Shipwreck, loss of cargo, injuries, and dangers to our lives." But the officer in charge of the prisoners listened more to the ship's captain and the owner than to Paul. And since Fairhavens was an exposed harbor, a poor place to spend the winter, most of the crew wanted to go to Phoenix, further up the coast of Crete, and spend the winter there. Phoenix was a good harbor with only southwest and northwest exposure. When a light wind began blowing from the south, the sailors thought they could make it. It was just a little trouble coming and a little thing coming, and we think that we can make it. So they pulled up anchor and sailed along close to the shore. Just stay close to Jesus. But the weather changed abruptly. Don't you know our circumstances could change like that? And a wind of typhoon strength, a northeastern call, they called it, caught the ship and blew it in out to sea. They couldn't turn the ship into the wind, so they gave up and let it run before the gale. Sometimes our situation and our storms in our life can get so where we just want to give up. We sailed behind a small island named Carta, where with great difficulty we hoisted aboard the lifeboat that was being towed behind us. Then we banded the ship with ropes to strengthen the hull. The sailors were afraid of being driven across to the sandbars of Syrtis, off the African coast. So they lowered the sea anchor and were then thus driven before the wind. They didn't lower it all the way, but they just lowered enough just to try to slow the ship down. Try to slow it down in the midst of a storm. The next day, a gale force winds continued to batter the ship. The crew began throwing the cargo overboard. The following day, they even threw out the ship's equipment and everything else they could lay their hands on. The terrible storm raged, unabated, for many days, blotting out the sun and the stars, until at last all hope was gone. Now, if I'm thinking right now, I've been in the storm too long. That song, I've been in the storm too long. All right, sing it, Sister Brenda. No one had eaten for a long time. Don't you know when trouble comes, you're in the storm, you lose your sense of appetite. Finally, Paul called the crew together and said, men, you shall have listened to me in the first place and not left Fair Havens. You will have avoided all this injury and loss. But take courage. None of you will lose your lives. God has a plan in the midst of our storm. For each and every, God has a plan or purpose for the storm. He said, you would have avoided this all this injury and loss. But take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. For last night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me. And he said, don't be afraid, Paul. For you will surely stand trial before Caesar. What's more, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone sailing with you. So take courage, for I believe God. It will be just as he said. But we will be shipwrecked on an island. About midnight on the 14th night of the storm, way too long in the storm, as we were being driven across the Sea of Adria, the sailors sensed land was near. They took soundings and found the water was only 120 feet deep. A little later, they sounded and found only 90 feet. At this rate, they were afraid we will soon be driven across the rocks along the shore. So they threw out four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. Then the sailors tried to abandon the ship. They lowered the lifeboat as though they were going to put out anchors from the prow. But Paul said to the commanding officer and the soldiers, you will all die unless sailors stay on board. So the soldiers cut the ropes and let the boat fall off. We're going to go to that 29th verse. We're going to take the text from there. At this rate, they were afraid. We will soon be driven across the rocks along the shore. So they threw out four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. There's a lot of situations in this 29th verse, but the title of this message is Anchored. Anchored. In that 29th verse, the rate they were afraid, there was danger, the rocks. And they were at night. So when we are in the storm, we have to learn how to be encouraged. We have to encourage ourselves, or we have to totally depend and trust in the Lord. Now, being a sailor, you know, the anchor is let down in emergencies. And there's all types of anchors. But there would be a time in our life that a real storm will come. Now I'm going to try to throw this into the spiritual realm. But when we're in a storm, I experienced being in a storm on board a ship. And being in the North Atlantic in a storm just for 2 days
That brought on some fear. Because the way the ships were taking rolls, it was about like we were going to capsize. But because of what the captain had to do as far as transferring fuel and water to different tanks to keep the ship ballast, to keep it from overturning and capsizing, they had to take some strategy and some planning. But when you're in the midst of the storm, there's no time to try to work out a plan. There's no time to be switching fuel and water and everything to try to keep to survive. We have to work on this thing right now. Amen. So when the storm comes, we are ballast. We can stay afloat and not capsize or turn over to where we drown. As we have experienced this recent hurricane, Irma, you know, we felt the little winds come initially. But as the hurricane got closer, the winds got stronger. And the rains became more. And it became darker, and the clouds became. So it was very dangerous being outside, because you don't know, riding in the darkness, where the floods are or where the trees might fall. Hallelujah. So in the midst of a storm, there are dangers. And when storms come, the winds and the water come to damage. Being in that storm on sea, it damaged the boat davit. The water was so strong, it ripped the boat davit. And the boat davit is something that was used to let down the boat into the water. Well, the davit was made out of aluminum, and the wells were broken by the force of the water, riding out the storms of life. So it was very dangerous in this passage where Paul was being taken captive to Rome, where he would eventually die. But he went through many storms along the way as he journeyed toward the end of his life. And as we are reminded here in 2 Corinthians, Paul list all the trials that he was going through. Paul said that they say they are Hebrews. They say that they are Israelites. But Paul said, 5 different times, Jews gave me 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent a whole night and a day drifting at sea. I have traveled many weary miles. I have faced danger from flooded rivers and from robbers. I have faced danger from my own people, the Jews, as well as from the Gentiles. I have faced dangers in cities and in the desert. And on stormy seas, and I have faced danger from men who claim to be Christians but are not. So Paul had went through several storms in his life before his death. And here in the scripture here, they had to throw out 4 anchors in order to keep the ship still, so it wouldn't dash up against the rocks. But ordinarily, on a naval vessel, there is 1 anchor. And there are all types of anchor. You have the Danforth anchor. You have a Union anchor. You have a stockless anchor. And of course, you have the Navy stockless anchor. And with the anchor, you have these flukes that stick up. And those are the things that dig into the sea bottom that holds the ship moored to the sea bottom to keep the ship still, or if anything, the ship is rotating around the anchor so that it's not making way or making movement through the water. But in this case, the storms were abruptly, they were raging. And if you ever had storms to rage in your life, it's not only you have to throw down one anchor, it's not only you have to throw down two anchors, but you have to throw down everything that you got to stay grounded and rooted in the word of God, to stay still in the midst of your storm, and trust and depend on God. So in this, I want to just spiritualize the meaning, and I want to just look at four anchors that I got out of this. Because I definitely need these anchors in my life to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. So the first anchor I want to look at is in verse 23. In verse 23, it says that, let me get it here. It says that for last night, an angel of God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me. The ship that Paul was in a life-threatening situation. And some things that we encounter in our life is life-threatening. And all aboard had given up. All those people that was on board was giving up, including Paul. But Paul rose up and encouraged them. Sometimes these storms come in our life not just for us, but it comes for others. And at the same time, it comes for others to encourage us. So storms come for many different reasons in our life. So in this verse here, 23, it says, that last night an angel, the God to whom I belong. So Paul introduced him as him belonging to God. So the first anchor is God. We have to be anchored in God. Galatians 2:20 says, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Christ lives in me. But Paul's life no longer belongs to him, and my life no longer belongs to me, but it belongs to Christ Jesus. So he had clearly identified whom he is and who God is to him. In verse 24, he said, do not be afraid. You must stand trial before Caesar. And God has graciously given you lives of all who sail with you. So not just only are we going to make it, but others are going to make it with us. Amen. I'm not going to make it, but my wife is going to make it. My wife and I are not going to make it, but our children are going to make it. Our children, my wife and I are not going to make it, but our grandchildren are going to make it. So this storm is not just for me. The storm is for all of us. So when the angel said, don't be afraid, he is saying that God is in control. And fear does not come from God. He said, for God have not given us the spirit of fear. Amen. Amen. But of power and of love and of a sound mind. So fear does not come from God. Fear comes from the devil. So he tells that in this scripture here, they were saying that they was feeling like there was no hope. Even in the midst of our storms, we feel like there is no hope. There is no way When is this storm going to end? How much longer, Lord? Why me, Lord? How did this happen, Lord? We have all the questions and no answers. But God is the answer. He has all the answers to our problems. He has all the answers to the storm. Just don't give up. No matter how dark the storm may look, no matter how much it keeps blowing, no matter how hard it keeps blowing, sometimes when the wind lets up, you think the storm is over. But then again, that storm comes. Those heavy winds may blow, and those storms may come. But my trust is in Jesus. Blessed is the man that trusted in the Lord and who hope the Lord is. So in some cases when we're going through our trials, and others might be going through their trials unsaved, but they are going through hopeless. But when we are in Christ Jesus, we are going through with hope. So God is the number one and first anchor. The second anchor that I need to let drop, that the flukes may dig in deep, is the anchor of faith. In that 25th verse, it says, so keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God. My faith and trust is in God, not in man, not in my situation, but my faith and trust is in God. And he said that it will happen just as he told me. Just as God said it will happen, it will happen. He is a God of faith. He is a God of promise. Amen. He will make a way out of no way. Yes, so even so, faith, if it has no work. See, Paul exercised his faith. Amen. Paul exercised his faith. So without that work, it's dead. Amen. And it's being alone. So we have to put our faith into action. Paul stood on the faith. As the angel of God spoke to him, he stood on the faith and he said, I believe God. I believe God. He saw the situation as it was to direct others. But that situation was to direct me. Hallelujah. That situation, it's no sense in pointing fingers at everybody else that you think may have involvement, but that situation is just to direct me. But Paul was telling, he said, we must run aground on an island. Hallelujah. Sometimes God has to do some things drastic just to get us over to the other side. We might feel like we're broken up, but those broken pieces will get us to the other side. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter how we get there as long as we hang in there with the Lord. We might feel like we've been beat up, drugged down, dragged through the mud, talked about, misused, abused. Amen. Feel like I had to just humble myself down and they took advantage of me. But no matter how I get there, as long as I persevere with the Lord, amen, that's all that matters. So that faith is that second anchor. While others have given up hope, Paul's faith directed the crew and the officers. So they seen something in Paul. That owner, the crew, the centurion, all of them, all those prisoners. But they seen the faith in Paul. Paul wasn't the only Christian there. It was Luke there. And then it was what is his name here? Let me go back to that first verse. In that second verse, it says, and Antaristus, if I'm pronouncing his name right, a Macedonian for Thessalonica. He was a Christian. So Paul wasn't the only Christian there. Sometimes we feel like we're all alone. Am I stoned? Too long. But we're not alone. God is there right with us. God is my refuge and strength. A very present help in trouble. So he is right there in the midst of my storm. He might not deliver me out of my storm right then, but he is there. Because he has to break up some things just to get me to the other side. It may seem drastic. It may seem unfair to me. It may seem like that, why me, Lord? But he just has to break up some things. Start throwing some things overboard. Those brethren was grabbing everything that they could to throw it overboard. All the equipment. Everything that they get their hands on to throw it overboard. Just to survive. Some things we just had to get rid of. Just to survive. Anchored. That third anchor that I'm looking at is ship. Some of the men wanted to jump ship and save their own lives. They were just thinking about themselves. Just save my life. And that's sometimes it's like that in the church. As long as I'm doing fine, I'm going to save my own self. They were pretending to lower more anchors, but really, they were lowering the lifeboat so they could abandon the ship. You know, they was pretending to be what they thought they were supposed to be doing. Sometimes it happens in the church like that too. Some people can pretend that they're going to help you out, but they really helping themselves out. It's all about saving their own lives. So they're pretending. So in that verse 31, Paul said to the centurions and the soldiers, unless these men stay with the ship, they cannot be saved. We have to stay with Jesus to be saved. We have to stay with the Lord in order to keep our life. He said that he came to give life, and that more abundantly. So we must stay with the Lord to remain saved. He said that we have to stay. So basically, unless these men did not stay with Jesus Christ, they would have lost their life. And this type, we're talking about the local church, and then we're talking about local fellowship. That's the type of anchor I'm talking about, is fellowship. Ship anchored. What is fellowship? Fellowship is two or more fellows in the same ship. We all in the same house. We all in Faith United America. We only need two people to have a fellowship. Hallelujah. Fellowship help us weather the storms of life. Amen. One might come with encouragement. We can be an encouragement one to another. That's why we shouldn't fail to assemble ourselves in the house of the Lord. And then with that fellowship. Ship is the third anchor. We're going to go on down here to this fourth anchor. And the fourth anchor is bread. Bread. Paul told them that they would not be able to withstand the journey unless they ate bread for strength. They didn't eat for a while. They was in a storm for 14 days. And he said because of the suspense and stress, they had fasted. They weren't eating. And we can get like that in the midst of our storms. Amen. We will not eat. But we need the bread. And what I mean by the bread, I mean the word of God. We need the word of God as our anchor. Amen. So that we can stay strengthened. Amen. Because we cannot survive on our own. And he said that I urge you to take some food. We urging you to take this word of God. Amen. Read this word of God. Digest this word of God. Understand this word of God so that we all can survive. The fourth anchor. So in conclusion, those four anchors, they will help us weather the storm. It will allow us to be safe on shore. And it will also help us to trust in God. And that faith so that we can act on the word of God. And then that ship, we need that church fellowship for support in the midst of our storms. And that bread, that word of God, that nourishment is for our souls. Those are the four anchors, and that's what I got out of this 29th verse. Amen. Being shipwrecked. I'm sure it is not fun. Being in the midst of the storm is not fun. Amen. I'm sure Paul wasn't jumping, laughing. Amen. Every day was a good day. But Paul believed and trusted in God. He had faith that the Lord would see him through. And most of all, he heard the voice of the Lord. We have to hear the voice of God in the midst of our storm and stay on course, stay on track. And if we have to, we need to throw all four of those anchors out to stay with the Lord that we may survive in the midst of our storms. Stay anchored. Amen. I pray that this word had helped someone. I know it helped me. I don't know what storms of life you are facing, but we all are going to face a storm. It might not even be your turn yet, but you better believe that we are going to encounter some type of storm in this life. Amen. But we have to be prepared. We have to get that preparedness kit together. Amen. That we may be anchored. Amen. So that we can survive the storm. Amen. Those of you that need prayer, want prayer. Amen. The altar is open. We're going to pray. You've done. We thank you for your word, Lord. We ask, oh God, that you continue to keep us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we don't know what it's going to take, but only you know, Lord. You know which way the winds are coming. You know which way it's going to blow. We ask, oh God, that you help us to be ready for when the storm may come in our life. In the name of Jesus. And when that storm do come, Lord, help us to not waver, but help us, oh God, to just continue to put our trust in you, Lord. We ask, oh God, that you strengthen us right now in our walk with you.
Lord, those that may be going through, we ask you, oh God, that you take them through the storm. In the name of Jesus. And when they get to the other side, help them to give you the praise. Help them to glorify your name. Because there's a purpose, oh God, that you're taking us to the other side. In the name of Jesus. Help us to hear your voice. Help us to be obedient to your word. In the name of Jesus. We ask, oh God, that you look down on Faith United Miracle Temple as a whole. We ask, oh God, that you touch each and every one that's not here tonight. We ask that you bless them right now in a mighty way. We ask that you keep them, Lord, in their right mind. Touch them from the top of their head to the sole of their feet. We ask, oh God, that you heal right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We thank you right now, Lord, for what you've done to save in this place. We ask, oh God, that you continue to cover our pastor, our bishop, our first lady. Continue, Lord God, to cover them in your blood. In the name of Jesus. Lord, now I thank you, Lord, for what you've done and what you have said. We ask all these blessings in Jesus' name.